This is a lesson summary video for the task titled Rabbit Run. This is a Solidify Understanding task. The purpose of this lesson is for students to create multiple representations and identify and interpret key features of quadratic functions. So Misha has a new rabbit. She named it Waskel, and she wants to build Waskel a pen so that the rabbit has space to move around safely. She has 72 feet of fencing to build a rectangular pen. So in this task, what we're asked to do is to find dimensions for the pen, for a rectangular pen, so that Waskel has the largest possible area for his pen. So let's start by figuring out a few different dimensions that could work, and then we can make an organized list so that we can create a model and find the maximum area for the pen and what the dimensions should be to create this maximum area for a pen. So we're looking at our perimeter being 72 feet. Now remember, perimeter for a rectangle is 2 times the length plus 2 times the width. So if I were to make the length 24, then the width would have to be 12. If I were to make one of the dimensions 16, then the other dimension would need to be 20. So for each of these rectangles, the perimeter is 72, and I know that the perimeter is 72 because you can multiply 2 times the length plus 2 times the width, and you will get 72. So there's lots of different possibilities. We, again, just need to figure out which set of dimensions, which length and width would produce the largest area. So I'm going to start with an organized list of potential dimensions. So I'm going to start with a rectangle where the length is equal to 1 unit. So for my rectangle, if the length was equal to 1, 1 plus 1 is 2. When I take 72 and subtract out those 2, I have 70 feet of fencing divided into 2 equal groups. That would be a 35-foot fence here, 35 feet of fencing there. So the width would have to be 35. If my length was 2, and I use 2 feet of fencing here, 2 feet of fencing here, that makes a total of 4 feet of fencing, leaving me with 68 feet of fencing to be split to 2 different sides, so I'd have 34 feet of fencing here and 34 feet there. All right, let's also consider when the length would be 3 feet, so that would give me 3 feet of fencing on each side, which makes a total of 6 feet of the fencing. That means there are 66 feet of fencing left to be split into 2 so that we could have each side of the rectangle. That would be 33 for the width. So now I'm noticing a definite pattern. Every time the length is going up by 1, the width is going down by 1. I'm also noticing that my length plus my width is always 36, which makes sense if you consider that half of the perimeter should add up to 36. So the length plus the width should be half of the perimeter. So length plus width equals 36, which means if I have a length of 4, the width would be 32. If I have a length of 5, the width would be 31. If I have a length of 6, then my width would be 30. If my length was x, my width would be 36 minus x. Now let's consider our area. Area for a rectangle, remember, is length times width. So let's calculate some of these areas. 1 times 35 is 35. 2 times 34 is 68. 3 times 33 is 99. So I can see that as the length is increasing, the area is also increasing. 4 times 32 is 128. 5 times 31 is 155. 6 times 30 is 180. Since for these areas I'm just multiplying length times width, I'll do the same here with my linear expressions. So that would be x times 36 minus x. So far my work makes sense to me because my area is the product of 2 linear factors. An area can be modeled with a quadratic function, and quadratic functions can be written as the product of 2 linear factors. Now that I have an expression to represent area, I'm going to take this expression and use Desmos to create a quadratic model. So that way I can look at other values of x and try to find that maximum area and what the length of the pin should be so that we have the maximum area. And I'm going to type in the function equation f of x equals x times 36 minus x. Now when I'm looking at my graph, I can see a curve here, but there's more to this picture that I can't see. So I'm going to go to my graph settings, and I'm going to adjust my window so that I can see more of this graph. I'll start with the x-axis. So right here, this is telling me that I'm looking at from where x is negative 2 to where x is 17.784, and I need this to increase. I need this to be a larger number so I can see further down the x-axis. So I'm going to type in 50 to see what happens there. Yeah, and there's my graph. It's coming back down. So I can see one x-intercept and a second x-intercept. And I know that this is quadratic. Again, I know it's quadratic because I have two linear factors that are being multiplied to each other. So x times this quantity, 36 minus x. The problem is I can't see the top of my graph. I know that this parabola is going to curve up and then come back down. So I'm going to go back to my settings, and I want to make this number larger. So if I make it 50, I can't see the maximum, so I'll make it higher. I still can't see the maximum, so I'm going to continue to increase this. Until I can see the whole picture. Now with Desmos, I can click on my x and y intercept right here in this x intercept, and I can click on my maximum point. And I see that when x, remember x represents the length, when x is 18, then the maximum area for that rabbit pin, that rectangular rabbit pin, will be 324. So returning back to my presentation here, I have a picture of my graph, and I have section of my table that does show that maximum value right here. And I did already know that this was going to be a parabola, that this is a quadratic function, but let's take a look at our first and second difference to not only get an idea about the rate of change of my parabola, but also confirm what we already know, and that this is a quadratic function. So remember, quadratic functions should have a linear first difference and a constant second difference. So to get my first difference values, I do 15 minus 308. So here the function was going up by 7. And then it's going up by 5, 3, 1, now it's going to subtract 1, and subtract 3. So this is a linear pattern that is decreasing by 2 each time. So my second difference is minus 2. Because as I'm going from one number to the next, and the first difference decreasing by 2. Notice that in this example, my second difference is negative, which is why my parabola is opening downward. Let's look at some of the key features of this function and what they represent in this problem. So starting with practical domain, the practical domain are the x values that make sense for this problem. So lengths that would work for a fence for Waskell would be between 0 and 36 feet. The practical range are values for y that make sense in this problem. So areas for this fence would be between 0 and 324. Remember, this bracket means that it would include 324, where the parentheses means that that value is not included. So anything greater than 0 and less than or equal to 324. Theoretical domain are x values that work for this function that has the equation f of x equals x times 36 minus x. The domain for this function is from negative infinity to positive infinity. The theoretical range would be from negative infinity to 324, and that includes 324. The maximum point was 18, 324. which tells us that when the length of the fence was 18, it would have the maximum area of 324 square feet. The axis of symmetry is this vertical line that goes right through the middle of the parabola, where x is equal to 18, which means that when you increase your length to 18 feet, you will reach that maximum area of 324 square feet. If you continue to increase the length, then your area will actually decrease from 324 feet. The x-intercepts are 0, 0, and 36, 0. So these are the lengths when the area is 0. The y-intercept is 0, 0, which is telling us that when the area is 0, the length would also be 0. The end behavior of the function. So end behavior describes what the two ends of this function are doing. And they're both decreasing. And the way that we write that out is to say that as x is approaching negative infinity, so as x approaches negative infinity, so going towards negative infinity, y is decreasing. It's approaching negative infinity. So the end of this function is going to continue decreasing as x continues to decrease. The other end, as x approaches positive infinity, so we keep going to the right and keep increasing towards positive infinity, y is going to approach negative infinity. It means it continues to decrease. The rate of change, we already know that there is a linear rate of change, but we can continue to describe the rate of change as saying that as x increases from negative infinity, y increases at a decreasing rate. That's why it curves. If you were to imagine that you were my cursor and you are climbing this mountain, the steps that you would be taking would be getting smaller and smaller. You would still be moving uphill, so your elevation is increasing, but the rate is actually slowing down that you increase. So as x increases from negative infinity, y increases at a decreasing rate, reaches a maximum when x is equal to 18, and then decreases at an increasing rate, which is why this curve continues to get steeper. So this is an example of the key features and their interpretations for this problem. That is all for this video. Thank you for watching.